Hello, everyone, and welcome to Hockey Night in Canada Online. I'm your host, Rob Pizzo, alongside Mike Brophy. Day one of the playoffs in the books, and Mike, it wasn't exactly textbook great hockey. No. It certainly was entertaining.
Oh, you know what? I've always said I love seeing goals scored, and of course, they say in the National Hockey League, defense wins championships. I got a little tip from a player yesterday that all six teams got together in a conference call yesterday afternoon.
Breaking news
and
here.
Said, let's drive our coaches crazy tonight. Defense right out the window. We saw some nice goals, though.
We did see some nice goals, but some defensive lapses, and really, no goaltender has jumped to the top of the list as far as a Conn Smythe watch early on. But we're going to get to all of that and more. I want to let you know how you can contact us. Jump on Twitter, at Hockey Night, at Rob Pizzo, at Hockey Brof with the hashtag Hockey Night. And you can jump on our Facebook page, Facebook.com/Hockey Night in Canada. And Brof, we do this every single day. We tell people we want to hear from you. What game do you think people want to talk about from last night?
Oh, geez, I wonder.
How about we start with, I don't know, the Montreal Canadiens and that exciting. I'm going to call it exciting, even though, as we talked about, a bit of a sloppy game. 5-4 overtime win. Dale Weiss with the overtime winner. We got flooded with questions and comments about the game. Good win for the Montreal Canadiens. That is a question mark right there. We had some other ones coming in. Habs and Bolts was one of the better games I've seen in a while. Great game. Go Canadiens. Then on Facebook, Shelley Mack says, can the Habs really win it all just like 1973?
I love this question because it forces you to go back and look at the 1973 Montreal Canadiens. You know, other than the fact both these teams are called the Montreal Canadiens, there's no comparisons at all. The 1973 Montreal Canadiens finished with a 52-10-16 record, 120 points. They were the absolute most dominant team in the National Hockey League. Scored 329 goals, gave up 184. That's plus 145, Rob. And you want to know another difference between these two teams? The Montreal Canadiens of 1973, who defeated the Chicago Blackhawks 4-2 in the Stanley Cup Final, had 11 Hall of Famers on that team. If you'll allow me, Yvonne Cormoyer, Ken Dryden, Guy Lafleur, Jacques Laperriere, Guy Lapointe, Jacques Lemaire, Frank Mahovla, Jean-Ray Richard, Larry Robinson, Steve Schott, 11 Hall of Famers.
We're all out of time.
I'm not certain there's a Hall of Famer on this year's Montreal Canadiens, but hey, I'm not saying this year's Montreal Canadiens can't win the Stanley Cup, but in terms of trying to draw comparisons between the two Habs teams, they're miles apart.
They certainly are. Now, I want to look at this game a little bit because you look at the dominance of the Montreal Canadiens in this game. They were sloppy as well, and Carey Price, we'll get to him in a couple of minutes, didn't necessarily have his best game, but I'm kind of wondering what Tampa Bay was thinking in the, let's just let Anders Lindback face about 50 shots and hopefully it works out for us.
Yeah, you know what? Tampa Bay Lightning tend to be more of a defensive team, although you always think of Steven Stamkos being that offensive force, but they're a disciplined team, and it all just went out the window. And it's almost like a lot of the players just had the jitters because it was the opening night of the Stanley Cup playoffs. I really expect them to play a much different game. Now, Stamkos did his job. He was absolutely exciting all game.
That first goal was incredible.
Yes, end-to-end rush. When do you see end-to-end rushes in the National Hockey League anymore?
And a snapshot from the side, a bad angle to go in. Yeah.
So, you know, but I really expect the Tampa Bay Lightning to be much better defensively in the second game of the series.
Okay, let's get to goaltending because a lot of people want to know about Carey Price, and we got one question in from Professor Villa saying, what happened to Carey Price, Team Canada version? And we had another question coming in on Facebook as well. Where was the Carey Price when Team USA played Team Canada? Tremendous sub 730 save percentage.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, as we talked about, Carey Price wasn't alone. It really wasn't a good night for goaltenders. And let's be honest, if the Canadians have a chance to advance beyond the first round of the playoffs, Carey Price has to be the guy leading the charge. They're a balanced hockey team, and they're a solid hockey team, but it all starts and ends with Carey Price. And he just didn't have a good game last night. 4 goals against on 25 shots is very un-Carey Price-like. The one thing I will say, Robin, you and I talk about this all the time. He's one of the more unflappable players in the NHL. And
I know where you're going with this. Overtime.
That's right. You know, I mean, he's not a guy who lets a game like this get to him. I think he'll come back and give the Montreal Canadiens a solid game. Where a lot of goaltenders, a bad game like this gets into their head and it carries over to the next game. That's not Carey Price.
I just, and the point I was trying to make there is, while he, I think this was really the only goal where he was kind of left out to dry and really wasn't his fault.
That was a great goal.
It was a great goal. You look at the way he played in overtime, and you hear about this and some of the great goaltenders of the past. They made the saves when you needed them the most. I thought he played great in overtime. He got worked, and there were long stretches of this game where he could have caught up on his reading and read a book back there because there was nothing going on in the Montreal end of the ice. So you're right. He has to be a lot better. He knows that. That sigh of relief you're hearing right now is from Carey Price because, really, with a game like that, you don't expect to win too many playoff games. Let's stick with this, and we'll talk about the other end of the ice because Anders Lindback, you know what, he made a ton of saves, but he had to because he faced a ton of shots. And MD Nathan wants to know, will Gudlevskis be stopping pucks in game number two? If you don't know who that is, it's the guy who pretty much gave the entire country of Canada a heart attack in the Olympics. Are we going that far, or are we seeing John Cooper going up to Ben Bishop and saying, if you can breathe, you're going to be in net?
Yeah, you know, I think there's a better chance of seeing Bishop in net than Gudlevskis. And I can't even pronounce his
Gudlevskis.
Name. Gudlevskis.
There we go.
And he did play great in the Olympics. But, you know, if Ben Bishop is not ready to go, I think you've got to go back to Lindback. He's an NHL goaltender. He had a bad night. You know, it was pointed out on the Hockey Night in Canada broadcast that he stays down on the ice too long. I also thought that for a big man, he plays way too deep in his net. And there, you can't let a goal in like that. I mean, if you're coming out, the shooter, Plekanec in this case, wouldn't be able to see that particular angle. So, hey, you know what? At the end of the day, he did make 39 saves.
He did.
So he's going to hang his hat on that. He's going to watch the replay of where he went wrong. He'll probably sit down and have a great tutorial with his goaltending coach and try to come up with a bit better game plan. But let's remember as well, it wasn't just his fault. That was a weak defensive effort by the Tampa Bay Lightning. They've got to be better as a team. It all starts in net. He's got to be better.
If you look at the overtime goal alone, three Tampa Bay Lightning behind the goal line. I don't care if it's Dale Weiss or if it's Gallagher, if it's Vanek. You can't let anyone stand in front of the net.
You wouldn't even do that in road hockey, would you?
You wouldn't do that in men's hockey. You'd be yelling at guys in men's hockey. Anyways, one more question in regards to this game, and it comes from Twitter. How do the Habs get away with all the tripping, clutching, and slashing without taking any penalties? This guy's name is Love Batista Fan. I have a feeling he's a Love Tampa Bay Lightning fan as well.
You know, I guess he didn't get the memo. Didn't you know the NHL wants the Montreal Canadiens to win the Stanley Cup? You know,
you're right about the Leafs, don't
yes.
you? Yeah.
I'm not one of these people who believes in conspiracies. I think you can watch one game and say that a team gets away with things in this one game, and if you watch them the next game, they may have a steady parade to the penalty box. The only thing I'll say about the Montreal Canadiens is traditionally they're a team that keep their feet moving. They keep their feet moving all the time, so they give the illusion that they're actually working and not cheating. And referees look for cheaters, guys who stop skating, guys who hold, guys who hook. And you know what? The Montreal Canadiens for the last couple of years have been a bit more of a physical hockey team. So I think referees, again, get used to seeing the Habs play that physical game. What are you going to do? Are you going to call them on everything? You remember the Philadelphia Flyers, the Broad Street Bullies, when Freddie Shiro ran the hockey team? His theory was very simple. The refs can't call everything.
Yeah.
So they went out and did as much as possible and just kept their fingers crossed that it wasn't going to be a steady parade to the penalty box.
I will say one thing. I was really laughing on my couch when Dale Weiss went right into Glenn Healy's area there and almost took him out.
Heels got to wear a mask.
I know. And then when the puck came in there as well, poor Heels. Puck went by him. Come on, Heels. That's the one save you got to make. Let's get to a couple of the other games that happened last night. It wasn't just the Montreal Canadiens, of course. Penguins, Blue Jackets. Game was bonkers. Would you agree?
You know what?
I used bananas, by the way, on Twitter yesterday. I guess we're going with bonkers.
Yeah. I've got to say, the Columbus Blue Jackets are quickly becoming one of my favorite hockey teams to watch. And we've talked about it, Rob. They're young guns. The guys that they're building around, Johansson, Atkinson, Boone Jenner, these guys are a really nice, solid core of skilled hockey players. And I felt in that game last night, they just weren't intimidated by the Pittsburgh Penguins. They had a great start to the hockey game. Unfortunately, when you're playing a team like the Penguins with the best hockey player in the world, and certainly Malkin came back and made his presence felt, you're looking at an organization who is not going to falter just because an upstart team like the Columbus Blue Jackets gets the jump on them. They've got too many guys who have been in playoff battles before, and they don't hit the panic button very easily. So I really give full marks to the Penguins for bouncing back in the hockey game. But if nothing else, the Columbus Blue Jackets proved to a pretty tough foe like the Penguins, that they're not just going to, you know, bow to them. They're going to come out and play some good hockey.
And, you know, I guess that takes us to another question that we got in from Facebook where it said, the Jackets should have won and they had an awesome lead, but they gave up a couple goals. What killed them? So they're not intimidated by this team. However, when you play a great road game like that, you jump up 3-1. We had shorthanded goals. Again, this one was a little sloppy as well. Is that a real letdown game? Can they bounce back from this? Because you look at the Columbus Blue Jackets, youngest team in hockey, 26.1. That's how old they are, an average age. And then you've got all the pressure on the Pittsburgh Penguins. I'm wondering if this was just a huge, huge letdown for them.
It probably was a real letdown. And I think Coach Richards is going to pull his guys together and say, we proved in the first half of the hockey game that we can skate with these guys. But sometimes when you've got a young group like the Columbus Blue Jackets and they actually get the lead, they're sitting on the bench thinking, hey, wait a minute, we're not supposed to be ahead in this game. What's going wrong here? And sometimes it takes that 1 year of getting into the playoffs, learning what it's all about, to be able to bank that experience and take it to the next level moving on. I'm not counting them out because, as I've said, I think they're too well coached and too skilled, but they're up against a very experienced hockey team.
Speaking of big leads, how about the Anaheim Ducks? They jumped out to one really, really early in game one of their series against the Dallas Stars. We've got Ancan from Facebook asking, the Ducks are good and the Stars have some heart. Also, Getzlaf is a beast. He scored last night and took a puck in the face from Tyler Seguin. That just looked painful.
It really did. And you know what? I don't know. I have so much respect for Ryan Getzlaf as a competitor. In the last couple of years, it almost looked like he started to trend down a bit. Yeah. You know, he's won a Stanley Cup. You wondered if there was that same urgency. I completely take back any of those thoughts now. He is a beast. Last night's game, 27 shifts, almost 21 minutes of ice time, four shots on goal, two hits, and he gets smacked in the face with a puck. This guy is amazing. And let's not forget Corey Perry on his line, too. We always talk about dynamic duels, and this is one of the best dynamic duels in the National Hockey League. I even like those jerseys. Don't you like those colors?
I don't mind them.
Funky. It reminds you of Halloween a little bit, but they had a few tricks and treats last night as well. I just think that where I thought Ryan Getzlaf was starting to trend down a bit, I'm almost wondering if we haven't yet seen the best of Ryan Getzlaf,
which is a scary problem.
That is scary.
And you mentioned dynamic duos. I mean, on the other side, you do have Seguin and Ben, so it's the battle of dynamic duos. But I will say this, and I'm going to preface this with saying my predictions are usually wrong. I've got Anaheim in a sweep in this series. It's the only series where I look at and think this is probably going to be over very, very quickly. But if you look at last night, I don't know if Anaheim necessarily led up or the Dallas Stars didn't give up. I was watching, and I kind of felt an element of both.
I'm more inclined to give the Dallas Stars credit on this one. They could have very easily folded the tents. You're down 4-0. You could easily start saying, hey, this game's over with. Let's start worrying about game two. But they didn't. They dug deep, and I think they did it to prove a point to Anaheim that we're not going to be a pushover. The season that we had was not done with smoke and mirrors. And, yes, the guys you talk about, Seguin and Ben, they each scored a goal. They are a dynamic duo, and we're going to see some pretty good hockey out of the Stars. I wonder a little bit about the goaltending of Kari Lehtinen. He didn't have a very good showing in his previous playoff experience with the Atlanta Thrashers, and this was not a great way to start the playoffs for him.
Four more game ones tonight, bro. We've got Philly, New York, Chicago, St. Louis, Minnesota, Colorado, and LA, San Jose, the game you're most looking forward to watching.
Well, I'm inclined to say St. Louis and Chicago because I think we have two Stanley Cup contenders, and I think it's a pity that they have to play in the first round of playoffs. I worry a little bit about St. Louis being banged up and not being able to give us, you know, the potential that we know exists. So if that game's not a classic, then I'm going to look in at Philly and the New York Rangers, geographic rivals. I think this one could get a little bit nasty, and I think it's going to be a lot of fun to watch.
Seven games? I think it's got seven games written all over.
Absolutely, and they should just play them in one night, just back to back to back to back, and get the ill feelings going.
Should let you know, Ray Emery getting the start in that game.
And I mean, like this, that.
Yeah, well, I mean, Mason is injured. Yep. He's not ready to come back, but I don't think we've seen a playoffs where this many teams, for whatever reason, be it injury or their starter is struggling or whatever, have this many question marks in net.
It really is. But, you know, I saw Ray Emery carry the Ottawa Senators to a Stanley Cup final. And quite frankly, he's matured as an individual since then. I think what the Philadelphia Flyers have is a much better Ray Emery than even the one who went to the Stanley Cup final.
That was 7 years ago.
It was seven years ago. I just think that Emery's really grown up since then, and he gets it now.
And we'll be back tomorrow to talk about all of those games and break them down as well. So, big thanks to you, Rolf.
Take care.
Remember, this is how you get in contact with us. Jump on Twitter, jump on Facebook. Even if it's during the games, something you saw that you want to talk about, send us a tweet, send us a message on Facebook, and we will talk about it tomorrow. And remember, CBC is your place to keep it locked for all of your playoff action tonight on the network. Chicago and St. Louis, game number one, and then the series many people believe is going to be the most exciting of game number one, LA and San Jose. For Mike Brophy, I'm Rob Pizzo. Thanks a lot for watching. This has been Hockey Night in Canada Online.